We often ask ourselves why some breeds of dog are so popular, but just one look at a Labrador puppy suffices to answer this question. Their cute look, the tenderness they evoke, make us fall immediately in love with these honey-coloured balls of fur and want to take them home with us. Advertising agencies are well aware of this and have used this breed for a number of advertisements. However, although we're enthralled by its looks as a puppy, as it grows we become more and more fascinated by the dog, its joyous nature, its lively and distinct intelligence, traits which are emphasised by its kindly and happy expression. Strong and powerful, always there to accompany us throughout our lives. This breed takes its name from the peninsula of Labrador, which was in the hands of the English from 1763 until it became Canadian territory in 1776. The Strait of Belle Isle divides it from the island of Newfoundland, also Canadian territory. Labrador and Newfoundland are washed by the Atlantic Ocean in one of the richest fishing areas in the world, especially for cod and herring. For this reason, since ancient times, this area has been the destination of fishing boats, coming even from far-off places. At one time, two different kinds of dog were common to the island of Newfoundland. One was large, the ancestor of today's giants named after the island. The other was smaller, about the size of a pointer, although sturdier with a wavy black coat. This was called the St. John's Water Dog, named after the capital of the island located on the Avalon Peninsula. However, most tend to think that Labradors reached Britain en masse from 1830 on fishing boats. These excellent divers and swimmers were initially used to retrieve fish escaping from nets, as well as to pull the nets aboard ship or to the shore, and to tow boats in the harbour or towards land. A description of these dogs by Bylandt at the beginning of the 19th century gives us an image that is somewhat different to modern Labradors, which probably arrived at their current appearance through crossbreeding with other dogs in Britain. This crossbreeding was performed to enhance their retrieving qualities. The breed was already known in Britain towards the end of the 18th century, and in 1814 Colonel Hawker wrote, "These are the best dogs I know for all types of hunting. Their sense of smell is infallible. None can equal them in tracing wounded game." According to a dog magazine published in August 1951, the first owner of these dogs we know of was the 2nd Earl of Malmesbury of Heron Court in Dorset, who lived from 1781 to 1841. Lord Scott also bred them, taking steps to establish their characteristics. According to a legend, the breed originated from a cross between a dog and an otter, perhaps because of its entirely water-resisting coat and the shape of its rounded tail, which is similar to this affable musteline. To justify this characteristic type of tail in regard to selection, some sustain that it derived from a cross with a pointer with this type of tail, although there is no actual proof that this experiment was carried out. Some believe that the bulldog was used to increase the already considerable strength of the Labrador and the pointer to lighten the structure and shorten the length of the coat, which was originally longer and wavy. In 1903, the breed became firmly established and acknowledged by the British Kennel Club. The Labrador Retriever may have originated in Canada, but it was unquestionably selected, perfected and established in Britain, the reason for which its paternity is officially attributed to this nation. The dog magazine already mentioned also stated that in 1951, the Duke of Dalkeith flew from London Airport to the States. He was one of the nobles in the circle of friends of Princess Margaret, the sister of Elizabeth, who was to become queen the following year. The purpose of this journey was to seek out people interested in buying his Labrador dogs. The Duke of Dalkeith, whose family had been breeding these dogs for over 60 years, stated that at that time, these were the only 100% pure Labradors known of. He also declared that his dogs had the double coat peculiar to this breed and could practically live in water. In recent years, the Labrador has come a long way and has become famous across the world. This popularity is widely deserved and gained on the field through versatile, varied, and diversified use. And it is common knowledge that this breed has always shone in all disciplines in which it has been used. The first Labrador Retriever called Brocklehurst Floss was imported to the United States in 1917. Today, these dogs are extremely popular in this nation, where tens of thousands of puppies are born every year and where they are among the best represented and most well-known dogs. The Labrador is a great retriever with an excellent sense of smell. It is tireless, loves working in the water, and has a soft hold which does not damage retrieved game. It is of average size, with an ideal height of 56 to 57 centimeters for dogs and 54 to 56 for bitches. It is sturdy, short coupled, with a wide skull, well-descended chest, and well-developed ribs. The skull should be wide, with a moderate stop and no prominence in the cheeks. The jaws are powerful, average length, sturdy, the teeth perfect, complete and regular with scissors bite, the nose wide with well-developed nostrils. The eyes should be of average size, dark with a kind and intelligent expression. The ears should be set rather far back, be of average size and hang against the head. Powerful and sturdy neck, fitted on well-set shoulders. Chest with well-sprung ribs, lowering to the chest. Straight top line, wide, short and strong loins, with withers extending straight towards the tail. Forelegs should have long shoulders with well-developed bone structure and should be straight when viewed from the front and side. Hind legs must be well-developed, with well-let-down hocks, never cow hocks. The tail, which is a distinguishing feature of the breed, should be very thick at the base, gradually tapering towards the tip, of medium length, without feathering, but covered with short, dense coat, which gives it a characteristic rounded appearance described as the otter tail. The coat is also a distinctive feature of the breed. It should be short, straight, and very dense, with no feathering or wavy parts, giving a fairly hard feeling to the hand with a soft, weather-resistant undercoat. The colour must be black, yellow or brown, from liver to chocolate, with yellow ranging from cream to reddish. A small white spot on the chest is permissible. Is undoubtedly a beautiful dog of solemn, sturdy appearance, built functionally and which charms us at the first glance. Nonetheless, beauty alone does not suffice to justify the great success the breed is attaining throughout the world, and there are breeds which, although even more beautiful than the Labrador, are not as popular. Even if we attribute part of this success to fashion, often oppressive and capricious even when it comes to dogs, it is evident that the continuous, constant and regular growth in the breed's popularity throughout the world must perforce be attributed principally to its nature and its extraordinary working capabilities. We have mentioned that the Labrador's work originally consisted in helping fishermen in Newfoundland working in a cold, wet and often fog-bound area. The dog's duties were to retrieve escaped fish, boats, nets, and at times also shipwrecked men. This is the origin of the love of water, which still today distinguishes all Labradors, and of its coat, characteristic of the breed and formed of short, straight, and dense hair, fairly hard to the touch and with an entirely water-resistant undercoat. When the first examples reached Britain, these characteristics were immediately appreciated, and appropriate crosses were made to transform the fisherman's dog into an excellent gun dog. It is well known that the British are excellent breeders, and this operation gave perfect results that led to the creation of the Labrador Retriever, which was deemed the best for all types of hunting, especially retrieving game and working in water, where it was unrivaled. The hunting instinct and ability in this activity are still a legacy of the breed, the extraordinary capacities of which can be seen both on the hunting ground and in official dog trials. The Labrador is able to work on all types of land, both flat and wooded, and is excellent in swamps and water, aided by its strong and thick-based tail, which it uses as a rudder to allow rapid changes of direction. Its characteristic coat protects it from heat and cold, dampness, water, snow, and thorns. It is widely used in hunting for ducks, pheasant, and partridge, and can work for a full day, tirelessly, retrieving up to 100 to 150 fowl and working on any ground, even the most arduous. It is capable of memorizing where the game falls. This is called marking, and once it has reached the place, of following the trail of any wounded animal that has gone into hiding. It is calm and obedient during hunting, is not quarrelsome with other dogs, and knows how to wait for the command to act. However, not even this exceptional aptitude for hunting explains its vast popularity. The fact is that the Labrador Retriever is also unparalleled in many other activities. Firstly, it is the ideal dog for every family. Its docile and happy nature, intelligence, sensitivity, intuition, love of children, and why not, healthy pinch of astuteness, make the Labrador a perfect and enjoyable companion. It can, rather it must, accompany its master everywhere, on outings to the country, to restaurants, to the sea, to the mountains, on walks, on holidays, and to hotels. There is no human social gathering that your Labrador cannot attend. In order to remain with you or its entire world, it will adapt to anything. Small spaces, long journeys, hot, cold, damp places and discomfort. It is willing to face anything as long as it is with you. Naturally, it would much rather prefer a nice walk in the mountains where it can dive into streams or along the beach where it can gallop along the shoreline, but for you, it would make any sacrifice. In the house, it is calm and, notwithstanding its considerable size, takes up little space and is not intrusive. It behaves like a perfect gentleman when among people. The Labrador has a dominating nature and a strong psychological constitution, perhaps inherited from bulldog ancestors, which, as already mentioned, it seems were used to create the breed. For this reason, if any intruder were to enter the house or threaten those it loves, the Labrador would undoubtedly react decidedly and surely. Moreover, its considerable bulk is already a valid deterrent. It is less suitable to guard territory, which has no sentimental value for it. It protects its master, its family, the house in which it lives, the areas surrounding this house, and even the car, but only if these are connected to the people for which it has strong feelings. It has a strong sense of protection towards the weak, which makes it instinctively love and watch over any child, not to mention people with psychological or physical problems. This characteristic makes the Labrador one of the most widely used breeds in activities to support or aid those in difficulty. There is one area in which it has recently attained extraordinary results. This is pet therapy, using animals to assist and provide psychological support for those with problems. In some countries, there are schools that train dogs especially for this purpose. The dogs, proving suitable, are then entrusted to families, but remain continually at the disposal of centres which organise their use when necessary. The Labrador has shown itself to be one of the most suitable dogs for this task, and is also used in the extremely difficult task of providing moral support for the terminally ill, where sensitivity, intelligence, gentleness and affection are required. The breed is also considered one of the most suitable to work as a guide dog for the blind, thanks to its intelligence, sensitivity, and docile nature, which make it easy to train. Almost everywhere, civil protection service teams have chosen to use Labradors for rescue work and to look for survivors in natural disasters. In addition to their intelligence and considerable strength, it is their sense of smell that makes these dogs irreplaceable in this task. The selection, which commenced almost two centuries ago to obtain a dog with an extremely well-developed sense of smell to use during hunting, was performed by expert British breeders to give dog lovers a Labrador Retriever with an unbeatable sense of smell, capable of following long tracks and finding even very old trails. For this reason, it is used to search for missing persons in some countries. Again, thanks to this wonderful sense of smell, police forces from all over the world use this breed to sniff out drugs in airports and at frontiers, and we often encounter them at work in our country. New emergencies have also led to it being used recently to sniff out any hidden explosives. To return to rescue operations, by making use of its qualities of tireless swimmer, the Labrador is used for rescue operations in water, where together with the Newfoundland it has proved to be capable of incredible feats. Many impressive training exercises and rescue demonstrations in water can be seen on various occasions. However, the Labrador is not merely a utility dog, but also a wonderful companion for sports enthusiasts. As already mentioned, its considerably docile nature allows it to be trained to perform a wide range of activities. It gives excellent results in agility trials, in which it is necessary to understand and memorize the different exercises in order to obtain as many points as possible. In addition to intelligence, speed and agility, quick reflexes and tenacity are also required in this field, and it is surprising to see how some Labradors, which are certainly not small, lightweight dogs, manage to come in first in this activity. Another sporting activity in which the breed excels are obedience trials, in which its character and docile nature stand out. Fortunately, the Labrador is a strong and sturdy breed, which has no particular health problems. Do not force it to live a sedentary life. It tends to put on weight if overfed. So look after your friend's diet and figure, as it is extremely sad to see a dog that has been bred to run for hours, dive into freezing water and work tirelessly all day, turn into a fat, lazy and lethargic animal. There are no particular problems concerning its coat, which only requires a good brushing each day to eliminate dead hair and dust. It must only be washed when strictly necessary, using specific products. Naturally, the Labrador may easily dive into water in any season or weather. The quality of its coat means it dries very quickly and almost always remains clean. Another characteristic of the breed is that it has no smell, even when wet. Care over purchase. As is always the case when a breed of dog becomes extremely popular, there is a risk of ending up in the hands of dog dealers. It is advisable always to choose a good breeder who knows how to select the nature, morphology, and health. As for all breeds of dog, care over bloodlines is extremely important for the future of pure selection, and only dogs that offer specific guarantees as regards morphology and character should be supervised and encouraged by the various breeding clubs. This is to explain that today there are some problems regarding the character of the Labrador, which at times may be too aggressive. Always a symptom of deep fears or shy and nervous in various situations. A Labrador with clean bloodlines is always sure and calm, never aggressive or afraid, with a solid nervous system and strong build. It faces the world around it optimistically and confidently, has a trusting relationship with man, and is very sociable. In other words, it is a great dog, which thanks to its characteristics has become famous throughout the world. You're bringing your Labrador puppy home. It's beautiful. Its sweet and tender appearance, its defenseless, although astute, expression, which reminds us of the puppies used in so many advertisements, the amazing liveliness with which it attempts to enforce its personality, cannot fail to charm its new master, making him feel moved, proud, and happy. You're starting on an extraordinary adventure, which, unless any unexpected incidents occur, which statistically are extremely rare, will continue for 11, 12 years or even longer. The first thing to do is to let the puppy get used to its new home, whether this is a house or garden. Therefore, it must be allowed to wander around without calling or disturbing it continuously. This is its first contact with its new situation, and its sense of smell is of fundamental importance in this phase to transmit smells and sensations that your new friend will never forget. Don't disturb it. Don't interrupt it, unless it is getting into trouble. Don't try to call its attention continuously. Everything must initially take place serenely and peacefully. Do not allow children to disturb and handle the puppy without a valid reason. It's natural that all that cuteness attracts pats and cuddles, but it is in these first moments that a calm and serene environment is required. As time passes, your Labrador puppy will become increasingly confident until it becomes the little menace which will accompany you for a few months and then the happy friend for long years together. After a few days of getting used to the environment, start to get your puppy used to the collar in the house. This should initially be left on only for a few minutes, gradually building up to a few hours. A choke chain is extremely dangerous and must never be left on the dog. After a few days, it will be time for the first walk. Remember that a puppy must not be taken outside the home for at least 1 week after the last vaccination. The first outing will be somewhat traumatic for the pup and should not be too long. Take it to a nice park or to the country, to a pleasant place where it can meet other dogs and familiarize with its own kind, which will instinctively be gentle and kind with it. Always remember that its impressions of objects, facts, animals, and people in the early days will influence its entire life, so it is essential that it has only positive experiences. Walks must be short, as the puppy's bones are still soft and the muscles not yet formed, meaning that in addition to becoming tired easily, it is possible for dysplasia due to early wear of the head of the femur or the acetabulum of the hip bone, which is not yet calcified. Teach it kindly but firmly to only soil in the right place, to do what it should and not to go to places where it is not allowed, together with all the other things you wish it to do. During all this, never forget that the puppy will always try to comply with your wishes and please you. If it doesn't understand something, it is never the puppy's fault, but your own, as you have not made yourself understood. Brutality and violence never give good results with any breed, especially the Labrador, which is exceptionally intelligent and sensitive. Only the ability to teach it from your heart what you wish it to learn will give the right results. Teach it the rudiments of obedience at an early age, although without overdoing it. 2 or 3 minutes a day is enough. When the pup is older, about 10 months, it should be taught the basics for a happy communal life with man. To walk on the lead without pulling, to sit, to lie, not to scrounge at the table of those eating, to soil in the right place, are the foundations. Those who wish to test their ability in any of the activities described above, and for which the Labrador is especially suited, unless they are already experts, should go to a specialized training school, the addresses of which can be obtained from the Breed Club. A proper diet is essential to your dog's correct and full development, so as to be able to keep it in perfect shape and health. Some people believe that dogs can eat virtually anything, and therefore give their dogs all kinds of food, often recycling the leftovers from their own meals. This is a serious mistake, since what may be digestible to us and a source of nourishing substances often cannot be digested by dogs or is unable to be metabolized. A final piece of advice. It sometimes happens that a dog loses its appetite and refuses food for 1 or even 2 days. This is a normal occurrence, and in these cases it is a good rule not to always leave a full bowl of food down for the dogs. Instead, the food should be removed after a short time. Present the bowl of food again at the following mealtime after having changed its contents. In the event of loss of appetite lasting for more than 2 days without the presence of side symptoms, or if it is accompanied from the outset by symptoms of general suffering or exhaustion, consult your vet immediately. It is very likely to be an ordinary ailment, but in this case it is not worth taking a risk, and it is better to seek reassurance from an expert. We will now begin with a brief description of a dog's digestive apparatus. As in all carnivores, the stomach is of large dimensions, whereas the intestine is relatively short. Initial digestion in the stomach takes from 3 to 8 hours, then the food passes into the intestine where the nourishing substances are assimilated, which are then transmitted to all the organs through the blood. The stomach's large capacity and the slow digestion process allow abundant meals to be eaten at fairly spaced out intervals. Naturally, to keep dogs in excellent health, it is necessary to provide them with all the elements that they require, that is, proteins, carbohydrates, fats, vitamins, and minerals. When dogs were carnivorous predators, these elements were assimilated by dogs through the animals that they hunted, and which were generally herbivores. Afterwards, civilization has led it to feed differently, but it will always be necessary to provide dogs with the appropriate substances. Dogs produce energy from their diet, which is then used for the maintenance of vital functions and movement. The more active a dog is, the greater the energy intake it will require. Without going into detailed food studies that would require a specific treatise, we can simply say that dogs particularly require fats or lipids, both of animal and vegetable origin, and it is these which provide the necessary energy and which accumulate in the organism to provide possible energy reserves. The proteins that make up the large part of the animal's body are also essential. These are indispensable to the formation of all the tissues, especially muscles, and also constitute the basis of hormones and the blood. They therefore represent an irreplaceable element in a proper diet, even more so in puppies, which must build their bodies. Sources of protein are meat, cheese, eggs, and fish, which are well digested by dogs, and also soybean flour, peanuts, legumes, which are, however, digested with more difficulty. An excess of proteins is harmful and can lead to various kinds of disorders, depending on the conditions. Carbohydrates are not essential to a dog's diet. They are, however, very useful at the end of pregnancy. Starch, which is the most important carbohydrate present in the diet, is poorly digested by dogs and needs to undergo preliminary treatment such as cooking, flaking, etc. This is why if you use pasta or rice as a food for your canine friend, it needs to be boiled for a long time to eliminate a large part of the starch present. Fiber, which often accompanies carbohydrates, is especially useful in the diet of sedentary dogs, since it helps to prevent constipation, given the speed with which it passes through the alimentary tract. Vitamins are also necessary, even if in infinitesimal amounts. They are found in many vegetables and are synthesized by herbivorous animals. This is the reason why when a carnivore kills its prey, generally herbivorous, it immediately feeds on the intestines, where there are residues of partially digested vegetable matter. This also explains why, to your considerable annoyance, your dog often eats the excrement of herbivorous animals as soon as it gets the chance. A buildup of vitamins can be harmful, and therefore, if you use pre-prepared feed, you should carefully check the substances contained in the feed before adding supplements, and if in doubt, consult your vet. Minerals are essential to the diet and are supplied by foods. Deficiency in certain minerals such as calcium, iron, potassium, sodium, copper, and others can cause abnormal growth in puppies, also with serious consequences and general debility in adult dogs, or the onset of problems of varying degrees. There is excellent pre-packed feed on the market, both moist and dry types, that provide all the necessary elements for initial growth, and to then keep your dog in top shape. Even if you use pre-packed feed, you will, however, be able to give some fruit or other food which your dog will find tasty, taking care not to exaggerate and not to give harmful substances such as sweets, fried foods, rice dishes, fresh or soft doughy bread that are extremely harmful and which can also have very serious long-term consequences. Instead, if you want to prepare the food yourself, then follow the advice of the breeder who sold you the dog, or your vet's advice. As a general rule, it is worth knowing that meat, ideally beef, is essential. If pork meat is given, it must be well cooked in order to avoid infections. Poultry, meat and rabbit are also fine, provided that they are completely boneless. Giblets, although less rich in nourishing substances, are well liked. Fish is an excellent food and is best given cooked. It is particularly advisable for low-fat diets for dogs with digestive or skin problems. It is also an excellent means with which to make the diet less monotonous. Eggs are appetizing and supply many nourishing substances. They are particularly advisable for puppies and suckling females. Yolks can be consumed raw, whereas the albumen should always be cooked. Fats, such as lard and oil, are always readily accepted by dogs and are particularly useful during moments of work or physical effort. 1 or 2 teaspoonfuls of oil added to food are always beneficial. Dry bread is a good energy source, but it must be well dried. It is also useful for cleaning your dog's teeth and for keeping them in good condition. Pasta and rice are very useful, but as we have already said, they should be cooked very well to eliminate starch, which is not easily digested. Fruit and vegetables, even if not essential, can be given to dogs that appreciate them. However, the nutritional intake is very slight and is only worthy of note for the intake of roughage. Needless to say, the final element which is essential to nutrition is water. Fresh and plentiful, that must be available at all times. If in a bowl, it should be changed as often as possible, especially during hot spells. It is absolutely indispensable to dogs that eat dry and not moistened feed. The final aspect of the diet to take into consideration is the frequency of meals. From birth, puppies have their meals by following times that are spaced out by the instinct of the mother and the other siblings in the litter. The feeds are gradually reduced during weaning and are integrated with suitable foods that should be recommended by an experienced breeder or a vet. Between 1 and 3 months of age, weaned puppies should have 4 meals at regular intervals. From 4 to 7 or 8 months, the number of meals can be reduced to 3, further reduced to 2 meals at 8 to 18 months, and afterwards, if desired, down to just 1 meal a day, even if it is not harmful to continue with 2. On the contrary, this is recommended by certain individuals. The decision to have a dog is an important one to make, which must be thought over carefully without ignoring some useful basic information. The vaccination prophylaxis must always be carried out with utmost care to try and protect not only the puppies but also adult dogs from the most common illnesses. Generally speaking, a puppy leaves the breeder after having been vaccinated at around 40 to 45 days with a triad vaccine against canine distemper, infectious hepatitis and parvovirus. A second quadrivalent vaccination, also including leptospirosis as well as the 3 ailments already mentioned, is generally carried out after 3 weeks. An additional vaccination can be carried out after a month, again quadrivalent, to be then replaced annually throughout the dog's lifespan. A dog can be vaccinated only if it is in perfect health and thus also free from endoparasites. Appropriate antihelminthic treatment must be carried out normally twice a year. Different types of ascarids exist, each of which specifically infests an animal species, man included, and there is practically no risk of zoonosis, that is, transmission of the infestation from dog to man. It is important that dogs are also kept free from ectoparasites, that is, those that live on dogs such as fleas and mites, both of which are hematophages. Moreover, fleas act as an intermediate host for a type of taenia. Numerous specific products exist to free dogs from these annoying parasites, but one must not forget to also carry out appropriate disinfesting operations in the areas where dogs live. The arrival of spring exacerbates the problems caused by undesired guests, the mites that arrive along with the initial spring warmth. A run in the meadows through woods, perhaps near groups of farmhouses and farms where there is livestock, can result in our canine friend returning home with mites. Not necessarily, since some factors may exist which make a dog more or less susceptible, also depending on its general state of health, that can influence whether or not a dog will pick up these acari. They represent a grave danger to dogs because they transmit pyroplasmosis, a serious infection carried by protozoa of the pyroplasma species that affects pets and also causes death if not discovered and treated in time. The symptoms in its acute form are represented by fever, also sthenic, asthenia, pallor of the apparent mucous membranes, and hyperchromia of the urine that can also become brown-black in color. In advanced cases, jaundice and a comatose state, which could possibly result in death. The mites suck blood for 2 or 3 weeks, and once having mated, the female then detaches itself from the animal and deposits the eggs a week later. The deposited larvae, recognizable by their reddish color, are minute, like tiny beads. They also look for a host on which to climb, sucking blood for several days. They then detach themselves and after a few days change into octopede nymphs of bluish color. They become adults towards August or September. With the arrival of autumn, the adults immediately upon hatching then lay dormant in cracks in the ground until the next spring. In general, the mites attach themselves to less thick skin, such as ears, armpits, groin, between the digits of the paws. Therefore, as a precautionary measure, we should always examine our canine friends for signs of any undesired guests after a walk in the open. Correct dog hygiene starts with coat care. For most breeds, but not all, it is advisable to brush the coat almost daily in order to remove the hairs that have reached the end of their life cycle. The coat of many breeds requires specialized grooming, which is to be carried out several times a year. One must not generalize about the fact that a shiny coat is a sign of good health, since in some breeds it should have a tendency to be dull. Dogs must not be washed too often so as not to damage the protective function of the sebaceous glands. The skin in normal conditions should always look clean without dandruff deposits or desquamations of any kind. Should cutaneous alterations appear, such as eczema, alopecic areas, i.e. hair loss and failure of hair regrowth, thickening or the appearance of abnormal pigmentation, consult your vet without delay. Cutaneous alterations due to mycosis or mange are spread by contagion, but only in the case of particularly debilitated animals and when one fails to observe the most basic hygienic rules. Claws must also be checked periodically. These are normally worn down in dogs that undergo normal physical activities, but it may be necessary to shorten them with the aid of a special tool. Oral hygiene should never be overlooked, and especially in miniature breeds, tartar removal is necessary from time to time because it can cause pyorrhea and bad breath. Certain bones are available on the market that, besides constituting a treat for our four-legged friend, act as a natural toothbrush. In puppies aged between 4 and 6 months, the deciduous dentition is gradually replaced by the permanent one. Regular inspections of the mouth are advisable during this period to check that everything is okay. The existence of cardiopulmonary filariasis, a serious disease caused by a nematode parasite, Dirofilaria imitis, or the blood and heart, has been known for several centuries, as has been known the important transmission mechanism of the disease by the mosquito for about a century. However, it is only in the last 20 years, due to the rapid diffusion of filariasis in dogs kept for company and work dogs, that research institutes, pharmaceutical companies and vets have paid increasing attention to the problem. It is therefore important that dog owners are also aware, even if in general terms, of the existence and phenomena of the parasitosis. The transmission of the disease occurs through the mosquito's sting, which takes up the filaria larvae by sucking blood from an infected subject to then inoculate them into another healthy dog. The high contagiousness of the parasitosis is therefore easily understandable, in addition to its seasonality, spring-summer. During a period of around 6 months, the larvae in the dog's blood grow into adult worms that are situated in the heart and pulmonary arteries. In turn, the adult filariae produce small larvae called microfilariae, which will live in the blood. The dogs most affected are obviously those that spend more or less long periods outside, hence gun dogs, work dogs, and those that sleep in the open. The damage induced by the presence of the filariae is of considerable seriousness for that which concerns the cardiocirculatory function and initially shown as a tendency for dogs to tire easily and the presence of a cough or respiratory dysfunction. The vet giving treatment at this stage will perform different clinical and laboratory tests that will confirm the presence of the parasites. On the contrary, the damage caused by chronic cardiopulmonary filariasis is extremely serious. The alteration of the cardiocirculatory function is often accompanied by liver and kidney lesions and a state of generalized hypersensitivity in the whole organism. The prevention programs that have only been practicable for a few years thanks to the use of specific new drugs are simple to carry out and do not involve toxicity risks for dogs. After having carried out a test to ensure the absence of a previous infestation, the oral administration of a medicine once a month for the duration of the entire hot season will give dogs effective protection, also if they are stung by an infected mosquito.